And not a single sutta where the Buddha spoke about parami. The Buddha also never heard the word parami. We are so smart, we are smarter than the Buddha. We talk about parami. The Buddha doesn't understand what is parami. So this it's very misleading when you talk about parami and that you have to cultivate paramis over such a long time. And then when you look closely, where do you find this teachings about the parami? They come from the Jataka stories. And the Jataka stories are so childish, and yet so many people believe in them. The deer can speak, the rabbit can talk like a human being. The rabbit can behave smarter than a human being. The story, the Jataka about the rabbit, he saw the hunter hunting the whole day in the forest. He could not kill any animal, so he was boiling the water, very hungry and nothing to eat. And according to the Jataka story, our Bodhisatta in the previous life was this rabbit. He saw this poor hunter, nothing to eat. He jumped into the boiling water, committed suicide for the hunter to eat. Such childish stories, a lot of people believe. And even the stories about the Buddha, Vesantara, Jataka, because he wanted to perfect his parami of giving, he gave away his wife and two children to a heartless beggar. He knows the beggar will beat them, will make them suffer and all that. Still, he gave them away. Which contradicts the Buddha's teachings. The Buddha says, a wise man's charity must not harm himself, must not harm others. So in the case of this Vesantara Jataka, he harms his wife, he harms his two children, and he harms himself. All for what? So it's very silly, a lot of silly teachings now taught. In fact, talking about cultivating the paramis over four asankhya kapas and 100 maha kapas, we find in the suttas that the Buddha only took three lifetimes to get out of samsara. Not even one world cycle, in three lifetimes. And the Buddha said in a previous life, in this kapa, in this world, in this present earth, he met the Buddha Kassapa. And when he met the Buddha Kassapa, he was a Brahmin, so he had no interest to see the Buddha Kassapa. His friend, his good friend, the pot maker, Gatikara, asked him to go many times. He refused until the Gatikara pulled him by the hair. Then only he had to go. Then when he went to see the Buddha Kassapa, he refused to pay respect to the Buddha Kassapa. But the Buddha Kassapa, because Gatikara pleaded with the Buddha to teach his friend, the Bodhisatta, some Dhamma. Then the Buddha Kassapa taught him some Dhamma. After hearing that Dhamma, he must have attained stream entry because he changed completely and became a monk. After becoming a monk, he must have attained at least the first jhana. Because according to the suttas, after that birth, he went up to the Tusita heaven for a long time. But he came back to this same earth, that means within this same world cycle. He was born as Siddhartha Gautama. After being born as Siddhartha Gautama, as a small boy, about 10 years old, he could attain the first jhana under the jambu tree. So that shows he had probably attained the first jhana. And if he had already attained the first jhana under the Buddha Kassapa, I'm quite sure he would have become a Sakadagamin. So he is a Sakadagamin. His time to enter Nibbana is ripe. Sakadagamin is called a once returner. He comes back to the human rebirth only one more time. He must enter Nibbana. From there we can understand why Siddhartha Gautama, with such a rich, wealthy, happy family, he gave up everything and went into the jungle and lived an ascetic life until he became enlightened. That can only happen because he's a Sakadagamin. An ordinary person cannot do that. People will say you've gone out of your mind. Such a happy family, you leave and you go off and become a beggar. So you see, a lot of things in the suttas, if you study carefully, is completely different from later books like the Jatakas and the Abhidhamma and the commentaries and all that. Okay, I think I'll stop here. I think they discuss. I find it a bit strange, you know. Some people, they listen to my talks and then they are shocked. You see, all the Sunday schools are teaching the children about the Jataka stories and the Paramis and all that. Nobody pointed out that all these are not the Buddha's teachings. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so there is no any fault, control, honesty.
Mm-hmm. You see, we read the suttas about Mara, Mara Sanyutta. Mara is very powerful. So you cannot escape from me, you cannot escape from samsara. Yeah. What page? Yeah. When you practice the Noble Eightfold Path, you are practicing Sila, Samadhi and Panya. So when you have Samadhi, you will see things as they clearly, as they truly are. So you will understand the five aggregates as they truly are. So when you understand the five aggregates as they truly are, then you let go of the five aggregates. Yeah. 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 Not necessary. But then generally, if you study the Dhamma, then you study all. You will study the elements, you will study the six senses, you will study dependent origination, you will study the five aggregates, everything. But if you specialize in one, like for example, five aggregates, if you understand it, and this is enough. Mm-hmm. Yes, you can use your own inclination, but one thing you have to bear in mind that they are quite related. Quite related. Yeah.
We can see it's intertwined with the five aggregates.
Correct.
So we can't help but to contemplate and go.
Yes, yeah. Yeah, listening.
Okay. I read one of the sutras. I think Buddha's time was, there are many people who go for and they also destroy. And then I'm thinking that, is it because we are equity is not there or because the blessing is not there? Or what is the reason behind? Because during that time, we really met Buddha. So Buddha has so many psyche and so compassion and so powerful, with a lot of, then how come there are people that, is it because the blessing is not there or the
even though during the Buddha's time disciples of the Buddha disrobed, but I'm quite sure the percent is much less than now. Now, because the teacher is not Sammasambuddha who can read your mind, so more people disrobe. And During the Buddha's time, those who disrobe, I think they don't have wisdom. Because if you look into the cases, there was one, after he disrobed, he was talking bad about the Buddha. And he said, according to the sutta, it seems one of the reasons why he disrobed was that he kept asking the Buddha to show him psychic power. And the Buddha refused to show him psychic power, so he assumed that the Buddha had no psychic power. And then he said, those external ascetics are so ascetic, they practice all kinds of what we call ku sing, ascetic practices, austerities, whereas the Buddha never practiced. What he didn't realize was the Buddha had gone through all the austerities more than the ascetics, other ascetics. But because the Buddha found that they were quite useless, then the Buddha only adopted those that were beneficial, like eating one meal a day, going on alms round, wearing only one set of robes. So that the Buddha calls the middle path, but to some people it's already very ascetic. So if a person has got some Buddha as your teacher, and you still fail to make the grade, then there must be something wrong with you, not the teacher. Sometimes you find, like in the case I just mentioned just now, that guy had no wisdom at all. On the other hand, there are some like Devadatta, it was because of the ego and the greed for fame, for offerings. So it's mentioned in the sutta, because he showed his psychic power to the prince was so impressed, every day offered him the two meals, breakfast and dinner. And each meal, 500 dishes were offered to him. And if he had any decency in him, if he was really a monk, he would not want to accept 500 dishes every meal. And for him to accept 500 dishes every meal shows that the ego is so big, you see. He thinks he deserves it. So such a person, even before he left the Buddha already foresaw. That's why in there's one sutta about the Buddha saying the different disciples, the various monks, they are the same type, like those that follow Venerable Sariputta, all of great wisdom. Those that follow Maha Moggallana, all have great psychic power. Those that follow Maha Kassapa, all very ascetic. But the Buddha said, all those that follow Devadatta are all very greedy. Evil desires. So that's why our motive in wearing the robe is very important. Different people come to wear the robe for different reasons. Because nowadays you find many, they come to cari makan because they think you go out and work, it's very hard life, you have to slog, get scolded by the boss, and all that, get a lot of pressure and all that. Here, you just go on arms round and come back, do a bit of sweeping, and then you can sleep, eat and sleep. Some people think like that. They don't know that all this is taking on a credit card. As one of the suttas say, Brother Uy pointed out, you haven't become an Arya, you don't deserve. So...
Thick dust, you can't see.
Oh, yeah, much dust in the eyes. Yeah. Actually, during the Buddha's time also, because it's mentioned in the sutta that the Buddha taught the Dhamma, and then those people who have suffering.